Time is short, so we'll go ahead and get started. Welcome to this session on science in the public sphere. My name is Ben Weiner, and today we're going to tackle this question: how can we increase non-expert engagement with the knowledge and values of science? But first, I want to explain what this weird gnarled tree thing is on my title slide. You see all these different branches of science coming together with politics and law and sociology, just like we would want the day of action to accomplish, right? This is actually a poster for a 1921 eugenics conference that took place at the Museum of Natural History in New York. I'm sure many of you visited, and organized by a Princeton grad. And I wanted to start with this example of science as a tool for violence, as a reminder that our project here has a very complicated history, and that if we want science to play a greater role in public life, we have to take greater responsibility for how science is used or misused. So, I promise the rest of the talk is less grim than that. I'm not standing up here because I have the answer to this question. I'm a first year grad student in physics, so you guys probably all have much more knowledge and creativity than I do. But what I do have is some experience in design research and science outreach. So I worked on a project with IBM to recruit people to donate their spare computing time to computationally intensive scientific research, which is not an easy sell. And then generally in design, I've learned some techniques that we're going to use today to go from big, very abstract questions like this to more concrete opportunities for action. So, this is a two-dimensional problem. The first is that of scientific knowledge. You can see here a chart outlining the gap in opinion between normal U.S. adults and members of the American Academy of Sciences. And as you can see, these divergences are very substantial. There is a 30% gap on the causes of climate change, 30% on evolution, 20% on childhood vaccines, 20% on offshore drilling. And so there are lots of ways to read this, but I think one of the big takeaways is that the knowledge that we as scientists, or non-scientists in academia, have dedicated our lives to producing is somehow failing to gain traction in the wider world and outside of these, you know, this ivory tower. And this remains true up to the highest levels of government and business. The other angle is that of scientific values or ways of thinking. These are the pictures that first brought alternative facts into our political lexicon. And so clearly science has some notion of evidence-based reasoning and a relationship with the truth that is essential to democracy and just productive public conversations. That for whatever reason is becoming rarer in the news, on Facebook, and in just like public discourse in general. Another example would be that scientists tend to have a quite nuanced relationship with expertise, I think. So although I am not personally capable of evaluating most of the claims made by climate scientists, because I understand how scientific knowledge is constructed, I know that I should believe them unless I have very strong evidence to the contrary. So these are just two examples of how scientific values or ways of thinking can make a positive impact in the wider world. These two things are not independent. I like to think of their relationship through the lens of publics, as presented by Michael Warner in his wonderful paper that you guys should all go home and read. But basically, a public consists of two things. It's like a discourse, or a conversation, or a set of texts, and then the participants who, among whom they're flowing. And so the idea is that for some sort of discourse to really flourish, or some type of knowledge to flourish, you need participants who have certain shared values that allow them to read and appreciate that discourse. But the problem is there is no pre-given set of participants to any utterance, right? It's just whoever shows up to listen. And so actually the values that those participants have are specified by the way the discourse or the knowledge is structured. So I'm gonna make this more concrete. I work in biophysics right now, which although not a no longer a young field, is not quite old. And so you can imagine this problem where for a biophysics paper to matter, you need a very interdisciplinary community who knows how to read it and appreciate it. But the only way that you get that community is by publishing a lot of biophysics papers that sort of tell you how to read them. And so you can see that there's this circular chicken and egg structure to it where you cannot really disentangle these two things. And so I believe it's no coincidence that scientific values and scientific knowledge are receding from the public sphere simultaneously. And I think that any real solution is going to have to tackle this dynamic head on. So, what are we going to do about it? So this is a workshop. I'm not going to talk to you for 50 minutes. So the first thing you guys need to do is break into teams of like four, maybe five. I guess just whoever you're sitting by. And first you're going to have to decide what you want to focus on as a team for the rest of the workshop. So here's some potential directions I've outlined. This is by no means an exhaustive list. And these are all far too vague. So don't tell me that you want to work on like environmental policy. Tell me that you want to work on like fishery management in the Pacific Northwest. Something like really specific that you can sink your teeth into and come up with specific ideas. In terms of the format, you're all going to do this brainstorm individually for 3 minutes. Everyone's going to need some Post-it notes, so if you have some in front of you, if you can pass them around, distribute them. I want you to write one idea per Post-it note, and the focus here should be on quantity over quality. So like, just get a lot of ideas out there. Don't throw stuff out because you think it's stupid right off the bat. And so you have 3 minutes, starting now. Yes. Yeah, what that corresponds to this. So like, what do you want to focus on? So no like solutions yet, just topics.
Problems.
Just topics, yeah, sorry. Yeah, you guys are going to need to be in teams of like the four people closest to you. Basically.
The four people closest to me now agree on what topics to write.
So no. You need to all brainstorm, and then we're going to bring it together, and you guys are going to decide. Yeah. So sorry. Let's break into teams. So you four are teams. Yeah. Go ahead.
Ideas for topics.
Yes. Okay. So like, what aspect here do you want to think about for the rest of the workshop?
Oh, right now we're solo.
Right now you're solo for 3 minutes. Yes.
So we have to decide what aspect we want to focus on.
You need to write down as many ideas as possible. Yes. No commitments, just ideas.
I have some main direction here.
We should all be writing right now. Okay. Turn off your filter. We're post-grammar. One idea for post-grammar.
Post-grammar era.
One idea for post-grammar.
Yes. As much as you can fit on this one. All right, 10, 9, 8. All right. So, now that, who has the most bits of notes, first of all? Five? Does anyone have five? Five? More than that? Seven?
Five.
Alright, excellent. Keep it up. So I need you guys to divide into teams right now. Like I said, teams of like four people, maybe five people, whoever's closest to you. Raise your hand if you don't know what team you're on.
Hi. I'm Peter.
So you guys.
I misunderstood. It was supposed to be one for no.
You said for like 10 minutes.
I know it wasn't picked.
So I think we pick one topic now as a group.
Yeah.
All right, we can do three. It's fine.
Okay, so everyone has a team now. So now you have 3 minutes as a group to share your ideas and pick which one you want to work on. One advantage with Post-it notes, with one idea per Post-it, is that they move around. So feel free to like group your ideas and make and break categories on the fly, and I promise it will help you come to decisions more quickly. So 3 minutes, and have a direction at the end of it.
Cool. Yeah,
great.
Race disparity in education, particularly science education, getting resources to schools. Statistics needs to be taught for everyone, more than a lot of other things. Reaching the most people possible with resource info, and keeping and getting girls into coding.
Keeping and getting girls into
coding.
I kind of have that one. I just have about 85
lines.
Educating the public about what's going on top. I really like your statistics one. That's a really important thing.
Yeah. I think a big problem is that people don't understand the nature of probability.
Yeah, they don't.
And also the nature of the bell curves and averages.
I really like that.
I like that a lot too. One of mine was actually like how to get people like think about nuclear power in like a more appreciable way, and like statistics are a huge role to play in that too. So. And then I also had getting minorities into STEM fields, how to get young kids interested in sciences and math. And so.
And then the two of them.
Sounds like we all think the line is the same schedule of lines.
Sounds like all three of us also believe that statistics is a lack of understanding of mathematical
properties. I think that's a good one to run with.
Yeah, I like a lot.
I've been thinking about how, like in high school, the normal progression includes like calculus and not statistics.
Not bad.
And how wrong that is.
Because
calculus is never going to be used in their life, but statistics is incredibly important.
That's very true.
So we just have to like find
That's a huge oversight. I never noticed that. That's a huge oversight.
It really is.
I actually did take it in high school, but that was not
also,
normal.
It was like a class
for kids who took calculus junior year.
Exactly. We had statistics as an option, but you had to have already either taken calculus or not have, like, not have an extra math degree that you could take.
I'm a first-year grad student of physics in Princeton, and I've never taken such a statistics course. So.
Really? Take a statistics course.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I've had to learn a lot.
You took StatMag.
Yeah, I mean, the StatMag is like physics, it's not stat.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah.
So.
No, but I think it's a crazy important thing that a lot of people.
Yeah.
Yeah,
a lot of my
super useful.
I'm a recent PhD. Almost everybody in my lab, I'm the only one who took the statistics class in undergrad and undergrad. And I've only taken two.
Okay, you guys have like 30 seconds to pick a topic.
Part of that.
I wonder why that is. I wonder why statistics got missed.
Who knows? Yeah, that's a really good question. Maybe because calculus is useful for physics?
Engineering. We also have different
statistics.
Yeah, that's true.
I've
never used my calculator.
Alright, you guys are out of time.
Never.
Deadlines are crazy.
Outside of time. No, that's not true.
So, guys, what are you guys going to focus on today?
But I didn't actually have to calculate on it either.
Accessing, making it accessible to communities that don't normally seek out science through video.
Oh, excellent. Very cool. I like it. Okay, what about you guys?
We are focusing on making sure everyone gets statistics classes and statistics education.
Very cool, very cool. Anyone else want to share their personal ideas? Yes, no? Yeah?
We're talking about local education at the local level about energy and its relation to climate change.
Excellent, awesome. I'm excited to see where these go. So, the next step is you're going to come up with much narrower problem statements that. So, you know, we started out with how can we help non-experts do all these things? Now you need a much narrower how can we that specifies the stakeholder you're trying to influence, the action or behavior that you want that person to do, and then the place and time or the context that your intervention is going to take place in. And once you have a nice and specific problem statement like this, the solutions will be much more focused. And so you get 4 minutes to come up with one as a team. Any questions?
Piece of cake. How can we ensure that all high school students graduate with a basic understanding of statistical behaviors?
Facebook users,
high school students.
Or have we exposed Facebook users to
graduate?
At some point in their education, obtain a
structure.
Well, you don't have to. You can reorganize.
It's just words, right?
What is our end goal? Is it to like position make people more interested? Is it to make them more critical of like the facts that they hear?
Just to expose people.
Would it be? I guess in the sake that we have 4 minutes to talk about it, we're already done. Would it be better to frame this issue in like, how do we like make sure that this enters like the curriculum, or would it be better to frame it as like, how do we make sure that students actually get educated?
Oil is actually,
I think those are like slightly different questions.
Well, it might need to start with lawmakers, though, because if you don't train, get it to be, like,
it's not something you're going to get, like, an adult to just sit down and fun on their own.
No.
So maybe we change the question, then, to how can we convince policymakers and school boards to require statistics in the high school math education?
That's a good one. So what how can we convince
slash, whoever, I don't know, is policymakers the right group, or should it be like
parents to decide?
Policymakers slash,
I think it's specifically like, yeah,
we don't think we know necessarily exactly who makes
this by which to like have content on social media be screened.
How's it going?
Getting scientific value.
So how can we promote Facebook users to read scientific science-based articles on
yeah, but it's honestly
I'll get a big paper for us.
To have some
emotion. Yeah.
How can we expose users to the scientific process?
But thinking about getting it to the general public also is part of our independent school. I just wonder if there's some way to like create like a popular app or like game that create a game that like requires them to think statistically even without like sitting down and being like, this is a p-value and this is a.
Well, I was trying to think of something like Code Academy. But again, it's not a very like fun subject.
No, but like a let's do this activity like a couple of times and you get different outcomes and then like look at the distribution. I don't know. That wouldn't be super fun. It's not gonna be easy to convince people to play games like that.
We're picking one aspect of this whole problem to fix. I think this one's more concrete. Yeah.
So we want to target the policy direction.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So how can we?
I think there can be like
convince
in some sense like
policymakers and school boards
to have some like screening algorithm for like
statistics
scientific
accuracy
or something. And then Facebook has to actually make like a policy decision.
Right. Or how can we have a big piece of paper?
I don't think it should just be high school. It should start early.
Timelines, like,
and like really, how to put it into the math curriculum at all levels, appropriate to the age.
So
statistics into
the math curriculum,
the general math curriculum.
Yeah, throughout. At the age appropriate level.
Social media sites. Yeah, professor undergraduate always say things that they should teach, like imaginary numbers.
Yeah.
At like any age, but like calculus, but like can't be taught here.
No.
Like, it would work.
I think statistics can be taught really early also. Kids, I think kids pretty well understand the like chance and probability.
Alright, that's time.
I want one second.
Everybody, hold up your statements so we can all see them.
Oh, it's too small.
Oh, we're just right on that?
Oh.
I can't.
Yeah, I wrote it too small. So ours was, how can we convince policymakers and school boards to incorporate statistics into like the general standard math curriculum in schools?
Excellent. It would be even more specific if you talked about what policymakers and what school boards. So like middle school, grade school,
all of them. We want it to be like age dependent. So like elementary school students get elementary school statistics, and middle school students get middle school statistics, and high school students get high school statistics.
Yeah.
So it's going to be all the way through.
I like it.
Yeah, we dream big.
Okay. Anyone else want to share real quick? Someone pointed this out.
How can we educate? Go back and forth between parents and children. I think how can we educate families to understand climate change in their or our community?
You know.
Excellent. Competing teams.
So we've got. How can we incentivize? That's a complicated word, right? How can we incentivize Hollywood / TV execs to produce content that emphasizes scientific thought process now? Wait, no, we need an on.
That's okay. Prepositions are hard.
We had, how can we expose Facebook users to scientific thought and methods through their timeline?
I'm dusting that. All right, cool guys. The next step. Oh yeah, sorry, I didn't
want to
think
of it. We were talking about how can we convince clean energy employers to like educate or employ like current or former like, prison inmates for like to work in the clean energy sector.
Very cool. Great.
Now you have to come up with the answers.
No. That's your job. But first, you're going to make what's called an empathy map. You're going to take one of these big pieces of paper, you're going to draw this, and you're going to fill it up with post-it notes that meet these categories. And this is your chance to really get inside your stakeholders' head. So you guys aren't actually designing for anyone that sounds like you hate. But even if you think that they're evil or stupid or just you don't understand them at all, you need to like bracket all of those things and try to understand where they're coming from. Otherwise, you're just going to be preaching to the choir your whole lives. So be empathetic, be sympathetic, be respectful. And give us one of these in 5 minutes.
So we have one for each of those things?
So like literally draw like a thing with these categories.
Yeah.
And like put your stories. Yeah, but just fill in the blanks.
I don't know.
No, this is about, there's a context for all your questions, right? So what are they going to see here and feel and say and do in the context of your question?
Okay.
Here's our categories.
Okay.
I don't really know why.
Use Facebook
users
as their
state
just because that's just like regular. That grammar doesn't even
work.
So if we're gonna like begin to say this goes for money.
Don't like
that.
Facebook curates like presence of cyborg. They see that people don't know it right now.
Don't understand why.
That's more thinking field.
That's more thinking field. Maybe people trying to like pour up their kids.
They probably hear these things and don't understand it well themselves.
Yeah.
Here. and don't
understand. Okay, so we're not on the second.
I just really
said. What would they say or do?
They know. They would say.
No.
So they think.
Kids have too much homework, more government intervention and education.
Maybe more important this year?
Yeah, more important things to learn.
So, there's a reason that there's a thing that's not true.
They're wrong. Why do all my girls?
I'm wondering that.
They all do. They don't stick very easily.
Pain. School is hard.
Well, I mean, I think you would say that Facebook feels the duty to make the world a better place.
What would they gain? A competent workforce?
They're just able to understand.
And my professor is just able to say, hope the day of action is going well. I still think impeachment is on the horizon.
I attend weekly. It's looking worse and worse every day.
Just like send an email to the class to say that.
Assumptions.
Would they hear that we're saying that their kids are well educated?
Yeah. Americans are dumb.
Yeah.
They
hear and the liberal East Coast elite tell them they're dumb.
I'll put my Texas accent on for
now, I'm from Texas, and I just love statistics.
I just love statistics, so maybe it would be great if other kids got to see statistics the way that I did when I was younger.
What if we could see this competition?
Are you branded as like a East Coast person for being here though?
Yeah.
All these are negative.
For what do you mean at any point in your life?
Why wouldn't they see something as like...
Oh, yeah. Opportunities for their kids.
Yeah, that's also
opportunity. Think, good idea. Like me.
So mad.
We have so many things. It's quantity over quality.
That's the best thing.
Thanks, Ben. Alright, gain. Interpret that as you
know. Oh, they would gain ability to read.
For pain, for the front.
Ability to read.
Alright, you guys have about 30 seconds.
Rocket scientist.
Maybe they would do it.
Even outside.
Alright, we're killing it. We have so many post-it notes.
They're all falling out.
What a front. They are all on. These post-it notes are awesome.
3, 2, 1.
Maybe this paper is just like, oh no, they're going to fall off.
If you guys all understand your stakeholder deeply now,
we tried.
You laughed, you cried, and worked together. Now, the fun part, we're going to come up with ideas. And so you need to think back to your how can we statement. You need to think about the stakeholder map, the empathy map that you just made. And you need to come up with ideas that answer that question in the context of your empathy map. And so we're going to start again with individual brainstorming. One idea for post-it. Especially here, quantity of ideas over quality, like wild, crazy things are totally okay and good. And then after that, we'll bring it
then
together.
Assume that the kids,
any questions
about the children and that the kids will be
your brainstorming answers or solutions to the how can we
equipped for their future.
All right,
are we applying our specific arguments here, or are we like talking about more like? Who do we go talk to? Like, how do we mobilize people? Like, it's just the three of us calling like random local school boards. But
I don't have any idea. He didn't tell us.
How would you approach the school boards? Like, if we were actually like going to do this, like, what would be your first step?
You would get people.
First step, sorry, not.
Like with all like the Obamacare stuff, you'd get like a bunch of people to call.
You can also talk to existing NGOs that work for
individually? Yes. One idea for Post-it.
Get some rich folks to invest in this.
Get Nate Silver.
Yeah, Nate Silver.
So get people to call reps. How do we get people excited about teaching their kids?
You have to do something like more like publicly on social media first to get people excited, and then have them like be mobilized.
Is there anything in life that is heavily kind of eagerly pinpointed as reliant on statistical probability or statistics?
Politics.
Yeah. The election.
Global warming. Anything with big data.
I mean something like personal to a person. People are more likely to be interested in it. Like personal finance.
I think the central problem with statistics might be that we as humans like live very individual lives, yeah. So we see like a single thing.
Right.
Whereas statistics is like you have to like look at it from a larger view. That's not like.
No, there's nothing like personal.
Finance is pretty good.
Traffic. I think traffic's a good one. We could use. I just think that examples from people's lives might get them more excited about, of like, oh, I see how this could be applicable to me personally.
Sure,
people are less, I think, more likely to do it.
Like that.
I'm just thinking of all the sort
of classic. I think vaccinations work. Just like trying to explain illness and medicine. There's like a lot of like cancer.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, 30 seconds.
Maybe,
as many posts
about, like,
as possible.
Gambling.
Sure, yeah, gambling, absolutely.
Yeah. Is there any way to get the news to like pick up on stories?
You can't get the news, but you could do like John Oliver or something.
Yeah.
To generate like publicity.
You kind of did a show about that.
Really?
Yeah. That's pretty good. Would recommend.
Alright guys, that is it. Now
maybe,
you guys have 5 minutes to share your ideas on your team and pick one.
Maybe like one of our options would be to come, like, actually come up with concrete. Or like examples from
push science articles, show my friends the top timeline.
Are you picking one?
Article share.
Picking the best article. We left out everything about like the more like scientific programs,
they
get like the recent argument, the reference folders.
I think this is like one thing.
Getting people excited to call the reps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I don't know how we get people
but that,
excited.
But that requires something
like
another.
Yeah.
Get people excited.
Yeah. Like, you look at the issues that people have been like calling the reps about.
It changed their.
I saw this like, dumb lady be on TV. They'll put her in charge of education.
Not like, let's make my kids go through more important things,
yeah.
Which I as an adult never have, so I just see the use of it.
Yeah, maybe. Is it,
maybe it makes more sense to go through like an existing.
Yeah, I think the NGOs would take care of a lot of people.
Yeah.
So
there's places like this, there's one called the Gene, there's a bunch of smart.
So lobby them instead of along
yeah.
It directly.
lobby NGOs.
Okay.
Who already do a lot of stuff. That's cheating, right?
What?
to just choosing this
one. I think a lot of times,
I already have a realistic plan to to teach my children math starting very early. So I feel like just more. You have 10 kids. Yeah, exactly. Turn everything into numbers.
So
you guys have about a minute to continue sharing.
Is the incentive thing? I'm wondering how we can eliminate the echo chamber.
I think the generally good idea is for a general idea of
maybe when you edit it, you can start with this portion while you're montage.
I guess those would both incorporate ideas.
Okay, how do you end up with this?
You'd make an algorithm for that.
That was not your job this morning.
It's the goat.
But I don't even know the manpower it would take to read every article that someone posts on
machine learning.
All right, it's time.
If it doesn't have a sword,
you have to present it.
Well, actually, you are going to have to present it.
Wow.
It could be
So, for the next 10 minutes, what you're going to do is take your wonderful concept that answers your how can we statement and come up, flesh it out, and come up with a presentation that we call an as-is and a to-be. So you need to tell us a story. And the first is you get up and you tell us what is the situation for your stakeholder right now as they go about their day, and it should illustrate whatever you think is the problem with that scenario. And then tell us the to-be scenario, where you all of a sudden your solution is there and the world is like a happy, wonderful place, and we should be able to see the difference. The point of this is to get you guys to show rather than tell what your idea is. And so make it as visual as possible. Storyboards are great. Comics are great. Role-playing is great. If you're making a physical thing or like an app, like draw screens or like diagrams or sketches. So, you know, make it as visual and concrete as possible. Any questions? And you're going to have like 2 minutes to present. Yes? Good.
So we draw two versions of the world.
Okay.
One with kids.
Everyone's inside an echo chamber. And one of these echo chambers doesn't like sounds. These articles like,
yeah, their head.
You
see someone reading an article, global warming a hoax.
I think it has to be an as is to be, right? As is, it's not world on fire.
How do you know?
World on fire.
I'm not trying to cross out.
No. I mean, okay. We're on fire, and I'm not dead. So we have to like.
We're moving towards that.
I'm not saying we're not, but like they won't believe us, right? That's not how it is. That's how it will be in the future.
As is, Well, we can talk about the current employment situation, where there's a lot of jobs, but there's a lot of people who are not actually equipped to volunteer. So the current world is that children are not equipped for the current job climate.
Okay.
And then the future is, because of those statistics, they're more likely to be able to,
so,
I don't know.
So Bob and Sally are looking for a job. And neither of them know statistics. And so they end up working.
When they could.
And then could be they work for Google and fancy cars.
I think that works. I don't know.
Is that a good example of running for
Wasn't the whole purpose of this not that we want people to be able to like make a better life themselves more than make a better life?
There could be a sort of a
we're talking about like a more macro.
There could be a meaning
benefit to this. Yeah, but convince your stakeholders. I really think that going on
that's
like,
a good point.
People are really bad at thinking about the diversity.
What if we have job search? Where we have Bob and Sally looking for a job, and it's like big thing. And they're all applying for the job. Bob and Sally get it. And then, but they're like super confident. Like, oh, we got this because we're the best because our parents told us. And then the second one, they're like Bob and Sally, they're like, well, I'm lucky. So then they're like, well, let's work really hard. And then they get the job. Okay. So, as is, this is Bob.
So like, which you can tell the people on
he's wearing a baseball hat. So that we can identify him. And it's a fish. And this is Sally. She has curls.
You're good stick for art.
Well, thanks. Bob and Sally are in a big mess. 50 million people. They're all looking for a job. No, no, this is Jerry. So they're all going to a building.
But it's not censorship.
Google.
It's not stopping you from reading. It's just giving you the link. You can still click on the link, still read it.
No, I'm just saying, like,
I can read. So they all want to work at Google. But.
Wait, which is this?
This is Azure.
Okay.
I mean, they are actually trying to do this.
The distribution of people.
Yeah, there's obviously a lot of subtleties to what would dentists think some sort of.
So this like works like a multiple levels.
And here's Sally. And then here's all the other people.
Well, it's I mean, like they have is, like Snopes and they have like.
It's not like this needs to exist for every. Yeah. And it also doesn't need to exist.
But Bob and Sally.
This guy gets the job.
Yeah.
It's only for like.
Bob and Sally are like.
Right? Yeah. So this isn't about to be for like. We're talking about science. We're not talking about like.
Like crushing. Bob and Sally are like, we're the best.
This is like.
I'll have something up here like.
We're the best. Bob and Sally. B plus S. So second option. So Bob and Sally are like we're the best. And then the second option. Is
watching
Bob and Sally is option one. Option two, Bob and Sally are like, whoa, we need to work hard. We're not there.
I think it has to be an album.
Yes, we can think about
it.
So, Bob and Sally go to school.
Are you guys going to be ready to present in a word?
Yeah. Oh, we got this. They go to, how do I go to school? School. And then option two, Bob and Sally get the job. And they have lots of money. And they're happy.
So we got 33 seconds.
We did it, man. This is
publicable. Go Bob.
I don't call it a bad thing.
And then just basically people should move.
Is this like a
sound? What does it say?
Okay. Great.
Cool. All right, guys, that is it. Whatever you have to present now. None of us have enough time, so don't worry.
Someone want to explain this?
Who wants to go first?
We'll go first.
All right.
So.
And tell us, remind us here of your how can we before you.
So our. Issue is bringing statistics to school, and we thought that the best way to do that would be support NGOs that are currently involved in education reform by maybe like coming up with a narrative to tell policymakers about why we should introduce statistics into schools. So we made this beautiful comic strip illustration of our friends Sally and Bob, who are trying to get a job at Google. Bob's wearing a top hat and Sally has curls, and everyone else is normal. So Bob and Sally and a bunch of normal people are trying to get a job at Google. And the first case, and then this like basic distribution of like technical knowledge that would qualify you for Google. Bob and Sally don't have a lot of technical knowledge, and a lot of the other people have a lot of technical knowledge, so maybe they're better qualified. So the first case, Bob and Sally don't know much about statistics, and because their mom and dad told them that they're the best and capable of everything all the way through school, all the way through everything, they think, hey, we're the best, we deserve a job at Google. So they go to Google, and they apply for a job, but they don't get the job, and they're sad, which is not good for Bob and Sally. So second case, Sally and Bob are like, whoa, let's look at this. We don't know anything about statistics, and we're applying for a stats analyst job. And also in the second folder, this, hey, look, we don't know anything. Now we know a little bit about statistics. We know enough to say, hey, maybe we're not the best in our fields. Maybe this like whole like, above median, below median thing actually means something. We actually have to put in some more work. So they figure, why don't we go to school? So Sally and Bob go to school, and they get an education, and they learn about coding. And then they apply to Google again a couple years down the road, and then they get the job, which they're happy. And they make a lot of money, and then they go buy a house in Virgin Islands.
Excellent. That's what we all really want. Okay, who's next? All right.
All right. So, Connie is a parent in a small town in New Jersey who really wants to know about climate change, but she doesn't have time. She's got a job, got a husband, she's got three kids and a dog, and she's like, when do I have time to learn about climate change? I don't know what's right or what's wrong. And then in comes her town librarian is like, come to our climate fair. This is the little map of our climate fair. And so you got the entrance right here where everyone gets the map and the orientation. You've got the science fair where we will recruit a bunch of the students in the town to do science projects, sort of classic science projects about climate change issues. We've got the activism area where you have people writing letters to industry, people calling for congressmen, recording YouTube videos to talk about climate change and environmentalism affects them. We got a model UN front for the older kids, for the kids in like middle school, high school age, debating back and forth on how climate change legislation should be applied. You got a farmer's market featuring all of the types of food that might go extinct once the climate gets worse, and you have food justice booths and water rights booths. We have the climate monologues, where we have middle school, high school theater kids talking as people from affected areas who, like people from the Maldives or the Arctics, who are losing their way of life because of climate change, and then an area for cleanup, for cleaning up the local watershed and understanding how climate change affects the local environment. And so Connie brings her three kids and her dog to the climate fair and goes home with a lot of with letters that she wrote and information and some stuff from the farmer's market, because everyone likes a farmer's market. And now the parents in the town and the kids in the town know about climate change. Yeah.
Beautiful. Thank you, guys.
I guess we can go. The problem, just like the background, was we wanted to incorporate science into movies and TV and have more informative scientific material in like popular culture. And so right now, when people go to movies or TV, they're like passively absorbing information, which sometimes has some scientific merit, but oftentimes doesn't. And so we wanted to pitch to, let's say, Hollywood TV executives a way that they could make compelling movies that have to do with science, but that also is good for their bottom line, that is innovative, and that will get bring people to movie theaters and get them excited. And so the first thing we decided is we needed to have a celebrity endorser. So I am Matt Damon. And so just imagine that I have like a Boston accent, and the movie execs will listen to me. And so our idea was that instead of this passive model where people just go in and they watch a movie, it could be more interactive and use new technologies like virtual reality, so that everyone would have their own experience and they could explore. And so one specific idea we had was bringing one of those 360-degree cameras into space the way they did with like an IMAX camera, and have some astronaut mission where they use this 360-degree camera, and then people could go in with their VR goggles into the theater and everyone would have their own experience kind of looking around, and afterwards they could compare about different things they noticed, and it would be, they'd have a chance to kind of explore scientific concepts on their own, and it would be cool and maybe make money.
Right. Excellent. Thank you, guys. Who's next? Very quickly. We're already over time, so someone's got to volunteer.
All right. So ours was the how can we encourage Facebook users to look at more scientific content on their YouTube timelines. So you know, as it is right now, Facebook has some very self-reinforcing algorithms where the things you look at are the things they'll kind of recommend in the future, and people get very confident in echo chambers. So we have, as it is right now, you go into Facebook and you see a Kim Kardashian article has 100 likes, and then you're reading Breitbart News that your friend posted, and everyone's reading Fox and Breitbart and PragerU, and it's a great time. We learn a lot. But how we would want it to be and what we could design is you could have verified content that gets pushed up to the top. So it would be like Nate Silver does a lot of statistical journalism, things like that, where you can pull up science articles and, you know, raise scientist profile, like Duncan Alday is going to make science fun again. And you can also have some warnings about things like the Drudge Report, where they say, oh, global warming is a hoax. And, you know, you don't want to censor them, so you're not going to, like, stop them from reading the article, but you're going to have a little warning saying, look, this may be scientifically inaccurate. And then, hopefully, you know, you have a science news feed on the side where people can read about what they want, like, be more highlighted, maybe, and... Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. We have two more. Is that right? Yeah. Very
good. So we, our problem was that we wanted to put more STEM education in prisons and for former inmates. And the other problem was that energy companies need more skilled work. So we decided to come up with a for-profit company that would sort of pitch this idea at trade meetings to energy companies. And also visit prisons, start in a local area, and then sort of train these inmates and former inmates so that when they get out of prison, they can go to work for these companies, and the companies would then sort of pay our company for those skilled workers, and it would be a win-win.
Awesome.
Yeah. Okay, so we want to create, so our question is, how can we get people to compost? And how can we make it mainstream to compost? And we want it to be, we want to develop a media package that can be modified to a local target community, so that people who care about composting who are like dispersed can take this equipment that we're going to develop and, you know, deploy it in their hometown. So the idea is to create sort of like fill-in-the-blank formats, like to show people the path of their trash, where their trash goes, how long it sits there, when will the nearest landfill fill up, what are some of the health concerns related to dumping garbage limitlessly, and how can we encourage people to compost, showing them how easy it is.
Mm-hmm. And also looking, just incentivizing them and talking about, okay, these are some of the health concerns that might affect you, right, or how it might affect your local water and your air, etc., so that would incentivize you to care more, a little bit more about composting.
Yeah, also there are some economic incentives where you, each household will be charged $5 or something based on how much garbage to generate.
And then discounted for compost. Mm-hmm.
All right, thank you so much.
That in Switzerland, lots of parts of Switzerland, they actually charge $1 per garbage bag. And that actually works.
Let's do it. All right, guys, we are more than out of time. Thank you so much for coming. If you signed in on the sheet, I'm going to send out a survey that will give you a chance to tick off if you want to be involved in any of these issues so we can connect you guys, if you want to like get together outside of this and talk about how to work on these things. But even if not, I hope that you learn some new ways to think about some important problems in science and public policy, and you had a good time. Thank you so much.